Malveaux at the Lincoln Theater with Paul Robeson Jr. We're here on an occasion where Danny Glover and Harry Belafonte will have a conversation. And of course, Paul Robeson Jr. is here with me to talk about his dad, his legacy, and what he's thinking about politics, economics, and culture in the United States today. Paul, I'm so glad you could be with us.
Well, it's a great pleasure, especially to be to see Danny Glover. Actually, I've never met him. I've seen him just say hello to, and Harry Belafonte is an old friend, so yes. I always relish the opportunity to see him, and it's a great occasion. He more than deserves this award.
Absolutely. Now, those are two men that I see literally following in your father's footsteps. Artists who use culture to deal with politics, who have taken some of the similar risks that Paul Robeson Sr. took in terms of staking out a position no matter what the public situation was. Do you see them as inheritors of his legacy?
Definitely. And what impresses me so much about both of them is that they are unique in their own way. I mean, you think of either one of them, Harry Belafonte is Harry. He's not like anybody else.
Exactly.
Danny Glover is Danny Glover. He's not imitating anybody. He's him. And they're both, in the best sense, I am. They don't seem to require validation, you know what I mean? And so they radiate such, not only power, which is one thing, but an empowering aura. They help other people appreciate themselves more, not just appreciate the artist. And I think that's the difference, especially symbolized by my father, between a true artist and a great performer. True artists, as we say in the black church, they can give grace. And that's unique. That's a very special thing.
That's a lovely phrase, give grace.
Give grace. That's what it's about. What's my father's phrase?
Yes.
I mean, not his alone, but.
But you know, your father, these men in some ways are inheritors, but there literally has been no one on the public scene like Paul Robeson. Not only was he an artist, and an actor, and a singer, but he was a lawyer and a scholar and just so very much more. His multidimensionality is something that we frequently ignore when we talk about Robeson. You've just come from a conference at Lafayette College in Pennsylvania where, as I understand, your task was to talk about his intellectual development. Will you share some of that with us?
Yes, I must say it was, first I have to say it was a unique experience. I had no idea that I was going to find what I found at Lafayette College, small college in eastern Pennsylvania, maybe 2,000 students. And this conference, I have to say, unequivocally was the most impressive conference, to my knowledge, ever held anywhere, here or abroad, about Paul Robeson. Why? Because it traced his arc of growth in historical context.
Yes.
And everything, all of the pieces, were analyzed dynamically. That is, as he grew, the different pieces and the different presenters in all the different disciplines managed to show how Paul Robeson as a person used this piece for this and how he used it, and the other presenter showed, well, how the whole Paul Robeson used something else in that area, and each presenter managed to sort of show the whole Paul Robeson, take that particular piece out, and then at the end, the other bookend was put it back in place. It was a perfect fit. The fascinating thing is that because by the accident of history, not by any particular personal brilliance or anything, but shared some things with him that aren't on the record, that he didn't write down, that he didn't share with anybody else. So it's as if together the conference was able to assemble this very complicated jigsaw puzzle of the whole Paul Robeson with a few key pieces missing, but the context perfectly laid out. And what they had done is that the piece that is supposed to fit in the area that they're covering was lying around there someplace, right? So it was my job to go from place to place and try to fit the last pieces into the... So every place I got, they had set it up so that, oh, well, sure, there it is. And in maybe 3 to 5 minutes, I could explain why the piece went in there, because they had set it up so that I couldn't miss, really. So it was extraordinary to do that 6 out of 6 times in 2 days. So, and I found out that the gentleman who had organized it and his co-director of this whole thing, the two of them had been working one way or another on something like this for 29 years. Wow. They collaborated on one at Purdue University 29 years earlier. So this is 29 years of preparation, no wonder.
Well, you know, the Robeson legacy warrants 29 years of study, I think, in terms of just the comprehensive nature of it. The major contributions that he made, the way that he, as I think you say, challenged us to be better and more involved. And then, of course, there's that chapter of just the debacle of the way our country chose to treat this man.
That's true. I think it's interesting that if you read him on the record, never mind off the record, he expected it. I mean, he knew full well that was awaiting him and went ahead and did it anyway because he felt it was his job. There are the forerunners. Mm-hmm. He didn't expect a whole lot of people to follow him. They couldn't, actually, yes, because he was way ahead of things. But he felt it was his job, and he did his job the best way he could. I would say, I think he took this from Frederick Douglass in the sense that he continued to speak truth to power no matter how much success he had. And that was his special thing. Very few do that.
Absolutely. In this conference and in terms of assessing the legacy, what were the special things that you were able to bring that are just not on public record?
It's a fascinating question. I learned from that conference how to encapsulate it and not run on and on, as I have been doing up to now. James Baldwin put it the best of anybody I know. He said, the gift Paul Robeson gave to us is the power to perceive and the courage to resist. This conference gave me the opportunity to explain how and why he did that, and how he arrived at the capacity to think through how to do it and then deliver it.
And in a nutshell, how did he do this?
Having done that, it allowed me to go a step further than I've ever gone before and conclude something that's been sitting in front of me for 30 years. And that is to say, as he put it in his own writings in a more general way, to combine the power of the spirit with the power of the intellect and the power of the will.
Okay.
Three legs to a stool, then it's unbreakable. Unbreakable. Think of it. The will combines the power of the spirit with the power of the intellect. What guides it? The spirit. Whether you're secular or religious, it fits any secular psychological theory, it fits scientific theory, and it fits biblical religious belief. In scientific terms, he or she who can connect the calculating left side of the brain with the creative right side of the brain inside there in an intangible way, that is the seat of power of artists, and it can't be described in words. It can be in action and result. He worked on that somehow from a young man. Footnote to the above, he was a believer in the religious small R sense all his life out of the Amy Zion Church. Mm-hmm. Born in it, was buried from it. I asked him once, who's your role model? Answer, don't have any. After a long go round, he loved to do 20 questions. His sole hero, he said, is someone I cannot possibly personify, but I can try to live my life according to his spirit.
Okay.
Who's that? I tried Moses. No. You know what he said? Jesus of Nazareth.
Oh my goodness.
Not Jesus Christ now. Jesus of Nazareth. And he let me figure out the rest, so yes. Can you, so can anybody. That's it, in a nutshell. The conference allowed me to, in my speech, to put that in context, in his terms, not in mine, because it doesn't need any interpretation.
That's phenomenal. The Peekskill riot was a particularly unique time. Paul Robeson, prior to that, had books out, recording contracts, was making hundreds of thousands of 1948 dollars. Within a year of the Peekskill riots, his income plummeted to about $3,000 a year. Horrible persecution, the police indifference to just the mob in Peekskill, New York. How do you compare that time, just the ability of the media to whip up this mob, to where we are now, politically, in terms of moods and reaction to people, to ideas, to difference?
Comparison. Again, James Baldwin. Then we, as a people, African Americans, were relatively alone in America, in the best of our cultural forward look. We were just ahead of the curve. As James Baldwin said, right after Dad had died, said, due to Paul Robeson and others like him, we're still here. But the difference is, today, we are no longer alone. We are even less alone today, right in this country, and don't know it. We should be very conscious of that, and we can connect with that if we go back to Dad's legacy. Think broadly, not narrowly. And we got more allies than we can count that we don't quite see, because they're not flying a flag.
You know, I want to take it personal for just a minute, because I talked about Peekskill. How was that for you as a young person?
I was there, actually, and...
You were about 20 years old?
21.
Okay.
Let's put it this way. I was too dumb to be scared. Okay. Dad was wise enough to know all of the risks and what was in store for us, and had courage enough and wisdom enough and discipline enough not to give any inkling of how scared he must have been. So that's the two pieces of Peekskill that stand out in my mind.
You know, the of course, HUAC took Paul Robeson's passport. Your parents were not able to travel, and travel was such a part of who he was. In 1961, there was a particular incident. Don't want to spend a lot of time on it, but it really does speak to this whole notion of FBI, CIA, COINTELPRO. But the rap was that he attempted suicide, and now we have a lot more information. Can you just talk a little bit about that?
Yes. The CIA, in this case, the Operations Division of Military Intelligence, that's the Defense Department, which, footnote, gets 80% of the intelligence budget, not the CIA.
Okay.
Most of the dirty tricks are them with CIA assistance. The CIA points them out. The dirty work is the Military Intelligence Operations Division. The myth is that the CIA does all that.
Okay.
Dad was in the sights of all three. Both United States and their counterparts in the United Kingdom, MI5, but also MI6, and their military intelligence. That's six channels all focused on this man. They finally caught up with him in 1961 via a program called M-Cultra, which is the program of using then unknown drug LSD to drug unsuspecting, quote, enemies, foreign and domestic, and the hallucinatory effect is so powerful that it often leads to suicidal tendencies because of the sheer terror of it all. That's what happened, and brilliantly it was done by the MI6, I believe, in Moscow under the noses of the KGB. And since I got a whiff of it myself, and a twofer is too many coincidences, never had any psychological break, so-called, in my life before or after, and I'm 77, there is no such natural occurrence, at least known to science. So I got a minor one, fortunately, that's why I'm here. Can't prove it because there's no smoking gun, but a lot of circumstantial evidence. Enough for me to say, accuse him of doing it. But you can imagine, back in 1961, when the drug wasn't even known, I gave up trying to tell the story because I would have wound up in an institution. So that's the story. It will eventually come out because there are still witnesses, and there possibly may be a written record of all places in the files of the KGB still. So story's not finished.
And a similar incident happened to another.
Oh, there have been many.
Okay.
Been many. It's connected with the Olson case, where they tried this on one of their own agents, who was actually on loan from the Fort Detrick Germ Warfare Department. And like the British fellow who supposedly committed suicide, supposedly jumped out of a window.
Right.
It's pretty certain that he didn't, and that case is very much alive today after an autopsy conducted by the son, whom I know. So that's one of several cases and is linked to the British man, Kelly, who blew the whistle on the so-called weapons of mass destruction and then supposedly committed suicide. So that's a connection between the people here, the bad guys here, and the bad guys in MI6.
Yeah. Tell me about Paul Robeson's last years. He certainly seemed to have voluntarily receded from public view. You often went to receive awards for him, to share his words. What were his last years like?
Well, after what I just described, he was so powerful, actually, up here. He had so many cells. They couldn't wipe out enough of them to do to him what they usually can do to anybody else, but he was left with literally too many cells damaged up here. So he was half of what he was, still functional, still had his memory, but he was determined not to go out with the image of a sick old man. Let him remember me as I was, not the poor old guy, the victim. I'm not going to play that in death any more than I was willing to play it in life. So he, I wouldn't say he became a hermit, but he retired to Philadelphia, where he's among the people who grew up with, who knew him when he was just Reverend Robeson's kid, eating greens out of the common pot, you know, with the rest of the kids, and they still related to him as Paul, not the great Paul Robeson. I mean that too, but they weren't busy getting his autograph or anything, like in New York or someplace. So actually, he spent a peaceful and very, I would say, in one sense, contented life in fulfilled life in retirement. The upside was that every time he looked at the civil rights movement here, these folks are just flocking down paths that I sort of hewed almost by myself through these through the forest. What do I need a medal for? I'm just so happy to see him opening up roads now down there, the little paths that I cut up. So he felt doubly fulfilled. He said, I never thought I'd live to see this. The downside was he was living as less than half the man he was, which is one of the most powerful geniuses in modern history. And every minute of that was painful for him to live on as not only less than, but so much less than. And it didn't help that most people that age would have been happy to have what he had left, but it's unfortunately it's relative. So it was triumph and tragedy all mixed together. But he, I must say, the most courageous thing he did is he never once complained till the day he died. Well, never once.
You know, that seems to have been a facet of his personality, sort of in the McCarthy era, with that reduced income and reduced mobility. You don't have a record of him having been bitter or angry or complaining. You saw the fire that remained in terms of social justice, but you did not see someone who played the victim.
No way.
What, what is that, the Jesus of Nazareth again, or what would you attribute
the
that
faith.
To?
Faith. Exactly. It exactly. Exactly. Oh, maybe the epitaph, the best, is not the political one. The artist must elect to fight for freedom or slavery, which is on his on his gravestone. I've made my choice. I had no alternative. But Bishop J. Clinton Hogarth, in his eulogy from the Galatians, said succinctly, Paul bears on his body the marks of Jesus, but no cross, no crown. It was worth it. Don't mourn for him. Organize. Says it all.
There you go. Old Man River was his signature song.
Yes.
And it, and he changed the words. He took it from something that was relatively plaintive to something that was defiant and very, very hopeful.
Yeah.
Talk about that just a little bit.
Well, it's in the last two lines from I'm tired of living and scared of dying, from I keep laughing to keep from crying. I must keep fighting until I'm dying. This says it all.
Yeah. Do you, what was the inspiration for that? Do you know?
What was happening to his folks was the inspiration, because he got there over the arc of maybe 10 years.
Yes.
In steps, and finally said, well, you just got to go right at him.
Now, if he were looking at the contemporary civil rights movement, where the it's become more complex, you know, the signs don't say white or colored anymore. What do you think that he would say? And of course, I know you can't divine him here at all, but you knew him so well. How would he look at today?
He would say two things. One, the struggle is equal opportunity, not equal rights. Equal rights don't get you the result.
Right.
That's one. Two, I cannot understand, with the immense potential power that you now have at your disposal, why don't you have the will to use it? And then he'd be gone. That's it. He said, that's all I can do for you. I haven't been here in 30 years. I don't have a clue of what you ought to do. You figure it out.
Now that is powerful. If you don't have, if you've got the power and not the will to use it, and it takes us back to your three-legged stool.
That's it.
Yeah. That is amazing. Now, you served as your father's aide for 20 years.
Many years.
That must have been interesting.
Well, I tell you, I really got to appreciate him as a human being, because greater he was, big as he was, he treated me totally as an equal. All he asked is that I know what I'm doing, and if I don't know, I tell him.
Okay.
And three, don't dare lie to him.
There you go.
I mean, that's the one thing. That you only get to do that once. Mm-hmm. It's over. You lie to him, well, fine, I still love you some, but you're not going to work with me. Don't do that. No matter what you do is okay, but don't lie.
You know, we've been together before, Democratic Socialist Conference, other conferences. You don't always talk about your dad's legacy. You in your an intellectual in your own right, you've had a breadth of things that you've looked at in terms of the contemporary political situation. But I fear when I look at you that sometimes you get placed back in that box of Paul Robeson Jr. Is it a blessing or a burden to be a great man's son?
He taught me to be my own person. Look, I have a certain duty which I promise myself, not to him. To place his legacy out there for people to use and understand. Not to interpret it, let them do it on their own. But to put him out there for himself, by himself, and he would do the rest. That's one job. The other is to keep growing myself, and I've written a lot, I've done a lot, and so on. And I've never forgotten that, because he said, look, son, don't copy anybody else. You do that, you'll be nobody. Be yourself to the maximum. And I have tried to pursue both. So I was very clear what hat I'm wearing. The other thing I've managed to do is not confused when people see me and my voice is deep and all that, and they kind of confuse me with Dad. I realize that whatever mantle they're putting on me, that's not my cape. So if they want to see it, fine. But when the presentation is over, no illusion that I got that I'm him. And a lot of people don't make that distinction. That's the beginning of the end for you, if you go there.
In terms of your own work, what would you highlight about it? What are some of the things you've done that have been most exciting to you?
The most exciting thing is to be able to get to where I can combine and see the connection between the struggle of African Americans as a cultural and class struggle as well, and its intersection with class and cultural struggles worldwide. Where do Marx and Frederick Douglass and Lincoln cross, which they do? And don't forget Jesus of Nazareth, who indirectly inspired Marx and Engels to write the Communist Manifesto. That's right. The Chartist movement of England in 1832 inspired Marx and Engels to write the Communist Manifesto. So yeah, there's a religious connection even to Marx. And his successors, including Lenin, Stalin, and the rest, mangled Marx half to death. So sorry about that, my good friends out there, but it's time to deal with that. So I think I've been able to take that complexity apart and begin to put it back together again. That's my thing.
Class is a word we don't use very much in America anymore. Talk about that a little bit, because it literally, I mean, the gentlemen that you'll be with this evening, they talk about class in their work. And yet, if you pick up a newspaper, you rarely hear discussions of class. 60% of Americans, you know, scratching for survival, and yet the C word isn't mentioned. How come?
A plurality of Americans are working class. To be middle class, you got to make over $75,000 per household, period. So it's a myth that we're a middle class country.
The average household makes about 50.
only 20%, 18 to 20% qualify for that.
Right.
20% at most. Okay, that's one. Two, African Americans are still predominantly a working class people. So class is not only as important as race right now, it's indivisibly linked, but it's more important. Mm-hmm. So we got to learn that, or we got a tough road to hoe. Now, you're not supposed to say that, I realize, but it's true, in my opinion.
Class, you would say the class is more important.
Temporarily more important, because it's after the Civil Rights Movement, not before. Civil Rights Movement is the other that was important in the broad sense, culture, race, together now. Not race as color, that's nothing at all. Race as culture,
that is
crucial.
We're running out of time. I want to just ask what you'll say to Harry Belafonte briefly as you present him with his Paul Robeson Award.
Brother, keep speaking truth to power, and as the church folks say, God ain't finished with you yet.
Not finished with any of us. Paul Robeson Jr., just a delight to be with you. We could continue, I think, for several hours because I've enjoyed talking to you. You have so many stories, but we've got to wrap it up this time. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you for having me.
Sweat and strain, body all aching and racked with pain. show a little grit, and you lands in the jail. But I keeps laughing instead of crying. I must keep fighting until I'm dying, and all the man river, he'll just keep rolling.